Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening. Thank you for being here this evening. I think people will keep coming through, and maybe we can ask them to sit at the back, not to disturb people who are already here. So the tradition is that we start back on time, and we're not making an exception this evening. But thank you all for being here on time and allowing us to start on time. This is the sixth edition of a series which we hold roughly every quarter.
Yeah, it's been through about four months.
4 months or so. With this wonderful couple, AVIS and Vaani, who walked in one day and we started talking, and I don't think we've stopped. We continue talking about issues that matter to all of us, and how in the middle of all of this can we stay centered and can we stay happy. Now, happy is a word that a lot of people, especially in management circles, shy away from, I think, because they think it's something too difficult to quantify, it's a little mushy, why do we get into that area? But it's an irrefutable fact, and all of us know it here, that it's happy people and positive people who are most productive. So why we are shying away from this in the workspace beats me. Because the more we look at how our employees or our co-workers, team workers can be happy, the more we are ensuring the success of our projects and everything else we work. So what happens then, tends to happen then, is that nothing really matters, nothing is too large, nothing is too small. You contribute as a team because the entity that you're working for, or the philosophy that you eschew, or you relate yourself with, is far greater than yourself. And it doesn't matter. And I think the moment that comes in, it's not work anymore. You begin to enjoy it and you begin to carry on. So I'm really glad that we're able to host this series. It's a series called Heart of Matter, which is, in a nutshell, there's a line that comes on your invitations. It's what lies at the heart of matter, what matters most and why. And what we're looking at is really across philosophy, culture, art. Sometimes it's really visitors passing through and they fit into this larger, it's a very large catch-all kind of theme. But this series is called Happiness Conversations. And we're really looking at people who have either, through debilitating situations, it could be an accident, it could be congenital disorders, it could be self-imposed, it could be something that has come out of the blue. How have they, when they've been down, how have they conquered this, stayed on top of the game, and most importantly, stayed happy and positive? So as life coaches, AVIS and Vaani have been doing this by bringing in very interesting people. We've had six editions, this is the sixth edition, but the last five editions, we've had really interesting people who quite courageously shared their life stories with us. And we try and keep it as intimate as possible. It's about real life experiences. It's not about abstract theories. And I think in this day of WhatsApping and Facebooking and all the rest of it, we somehow seem to be losing this ability or even the physical infrastructure spaces for face-to-face conversations, to share, to support, and in that process, maybe recalibrate our own lives and think that we're not alone in some of the difficult situations that we have faced. In fact, there are people who have had far worse situations and they've come out of it. So, in a sense, without us being too prescriptive, it is at once motivational, it is aspirational. And if somebody here in the audience can take away something, then I think we've achieved some part of what we set out to do. So today I just want to welcome our guests Sharada, Arun and SG. Thank you for being here for this session. AVIS and Vaani will introduce them more fully and take away the conversation, at the end of which we will have time to take questions and interact. So I'd like to hand it over to AVIS first to take it away this evening.
Thank you so much. Thank you, one of you can pick up the other mic.
Yeah.
Arun, can you pick up your mic between you and Shankar? So, thank you, Rati. It's always a pleasure to have you introduce the program. It's fun when somebody puts it all in a nutshell and gets it going for us. So thank you, everybody. I want to place on record my greatest gratitude to Sundari, who's here, for joining us today. And Sundari works with the HCL Foundation. And when she expressed her desire to join us, this series, as some of you who attend it regularly know, is held on the first floor. And Rati's been, and her team at InKo, have been very gracious to allow us to use the gallery where there is an ongoing exhibition. They've paused it for this afternoon to allow us to have this here so that Sundari can have access to the program. So thank you, Sundari, and thank you, Rati, for being so gracious. I'm going to talk a little bit about why we do happiness conversations before we actually get into the conversation itself. So some of you know our story, and I see a lot of new faces, so I will go over it in a very, 30,000 feet view. For the last decade, we've been, Vaani and I and our little family, has been going through a very, very challenging phase. We are dealing with the bankruptcy of our firm, but more than a bankruptcy that happened a decade ago, it's the ongoing challenges of not getting work, not getting income, and not being able to even cover our living expenses that keeps us very numb. You know, there's a lot of pain, and it's very numb, as in it doesn't make a difference at all now. You know, it's reached that stage. And yet, we feel that we're very alive. And this has been through this experience. So somebody asked me recently, what did you learn from this phase? And I said, I learned to be happy. And the happiness that we talk about is a celebration of being alive. And the way we structure it, so that can appear abstract to people and say, that's a celebration of being alive. It's a nice romantic way of expressing it, but in reality, how does it work? And I say it is the art of being non-worrying, which is one of the things that comes between us and happiness is worry. And the art of being non-worrying. And the way we look at each problem, and in a day I can guarantee you there will be X number of problems going up to 5X, 10X by the end of the week. And so when confronted with a problem, we ask ourselves, can we solve this problem? If we can solve it, we don't worry about it. And if we can't solve it, we don't worry about it. So that's the art of non-worrying. You know, so you look at the problem and you ask this simple question. The second is the art of being non-frustrated. So we like to believe that because we put in an effort into doing something, we must want get the results immediately. And it's been 10 years and we've not been able to fix this problem that we're dealing with, not for lack of effort, but for lack of results. And so we realize that we only have a right to the effort. Now, I cannot face myself in the mirror, I cannot face Vaani, I cannot face my children if I'm not making an effort. But I'm able to face not only them, but I'm able to face everyone because the effort is there, but the results are not there. So we learned the art, cultivated the art of being non-frustrated. And the third part is the art of being non-suffering. Now, pain is inevitable. I think there are stories, we're going to hear their stories as well and talk about it. There's pain everywhere. I think we are all, in a way, soaking in the opportunity of being happy, but we're also dealing with a lot of pain. So pain is inevitable, and it comes unannounced. It doesn't have an agenda to cause our suffering. We suffer only because we ask, why is there pain in the first place? Why this pain? So, thalavelicha, pain. Yen in the thalaveli and ruketa, that's suffering. So, to us, happiness therefore is being non-worrying, non-frustrated and non-suffering. And that's why happiness conversations. So, we bring people that we can learn from, that we can share our stories with, and hopefully, as Rati said, if you take away something from here this evening that helps you along your journey, we would have felt blessed with putting this together for you. So that brings me to our journey here, which is really about inspiring happiness making you all pause and reflect, and we have three people here that will, you know, help us along this conversation. And I first met Vaani and I are part of a blogger group. I write a blog every day, so I share life lessons on that blog every day. And we met Sharada there at the Chennai Bloggers Club. And when we met her, you know, look at her. I mean, so full of life and very enthusiastic and bubbly. And then we, you know, she had just released her book. Your book had come out. Make It Two is a book, and it was a pretty interesting book because it's a book on soft erotica. You know, so and coming from a lady, you know, you tend to look at it and say, wow, it's a lady author writing erotica. You know, so we managed to grab a coffee with her, and that's when she talked about her life to us. And when we put the two Sharadas together, the Sharada that had dealt with her life situation and the Sharada that is now expressing herself, and we found a beauty in the contrast. And we found that, you know, and this was like a couple of years ago. So it's really been 2 years since we have known Sharada, and we're happy that you're part of the conversation. I'm not even getting into the detail of her story at this time because I really want to invite her to talk about it. SG here has, for his, you know, for reasons of protecting his privacy when the invitations went out, has chosen to be referred by his initials, but his real name is Shankar, so we can all call him Shankar. And so Shankar read my book, Fall Like a Rose Petal, which came out in 2014. And he was one of those readers who took the effort to write to me, saying how much the book had meant to him. And we grabbed a coffee with him, and when he told us his story, you know, we were like, wow, you know, I think, you know, whose story is more painful, you know, who's dealing with greater challenges. And so we know him also for a couple of years now.
2014.
Yeah, 2014, yeah. So, and then Arun, my brother, Arun calls me Anand, so it feels nice somebody calls you Anand. So Arun, Vaani and I met him at a storytelling session, where he just got on stage and shared a story. And it was powerful, and when we were curating this conversation, we thought we'd bring Arun in as well. So welcome Arun, Shankar and Sharada. Ladies and gentlemen, presenting our team. Do you want to add something before we go into?
Yeah, I think, thank you Rati for that lovely introduction. And you know, I just want to amplify two points. One that Rati spoke about, the importance of conversations, because I think, you know, in a highly digitalized world, which is, you know, giving instant gratification in the form of WhatsApp, I want to share with the audience that one of the tools that Avis and I used very effectively during our difficult times was to talk about a lot of things, because when you express your feelings to somebody, you really don't know how much of a difference it makes, because thinking about it is one thing, but when you actually say it, the spoken word does something to you, and it's actually very effective in clearing up a lot of things, even bringing clarity to the way you're thinking or on what you should do. So we used it very effectively. So I'm glad that, you know, InKo is supporting this, you know, heart of matter happiness conversations, because conversations are so integral to life, but I feel we are just moving away from conversations. So like she said, again, it's not prescriptive, we're just sharing, and you could have another perspective and we'll be happy to hear. The other thing that we're very happy that, you know, the three guests here have come forward to share their life's journey. It's a lived experience that all of us have had. One of the things that strikes me about all their journeys, and I can bring in some correlation from what we have gone through, Davis and I, And that fact is about the, you know, so-called unfairness of life. You know, a lot of us are fighting a situation that we believe is unfair. And who's being unfair? I mean, we're not talking about people here. Sometimes we feel life is unfair. Like, how can such a thing happen to me? You know, and we're fighting that, you know, how can it happen? You know, this is bad. But, you know, I think after all these years, one of the things I tell AVIS, you know, that life has a mind of its own. You know, I don't even know if, you know, what life is. I don't even want to go into that definition. But I think it just happens, you know, irrespective of who you are or, you know, what, where you come from or any such thing. It just happens. And thank you, all three of you, for coming here and sharing your story. I'll let AVIS lead the conversation.
Thank you, Mom. As the invitation would have made out, you know, these are stories of abuse, but these are also stories of happiness. Because one common thread you will see in all three stories is courage. If they are here with us today and ready to tell their story, it calls for phenomenal courage. And so it's, you know, and unless you're happy with the way your life is, you cannot face it. That's why I say that happiness lies at the core of all your responses to life and helps you anchor and move along with it. So the way we're going to do it is we're going to go through quickly over all three stories, and then we're going to get into a Q&A with you. Okay? So we'll start with you, Sharada.
Right. Good evening. I'm Sharada, Sharada Vijay, born and bruised in Chennai. I've been in Chennai for 34 years. Yes, I'm a woman, I'm allowed to tell my age. I'm not shy about it. I'm the only child for my parents. My mom works with Upper Lok, has retired from SBI, a very small family. I studied in an all-girls school and an all-girls college. Like every other girl in the prime teens, I also wanted to smell what a boy is because I was in an all-girls college, and I was introduced to this person through someone else, and I was very naive, very innocent, wasn't someone who could give me an ice cream, I would be like, okay, come, let's live a life together. That name back then. I think it was, I don't know if it was innocence or it was not, if it was ignorance or innocence, which I'm not too sure, but that led me to be with someone for almost 6 to 7 years, which is the period when I was abused physically, mentally and emotionally. And it went on for quite some time. For me to even acknowledge it was abuse, it took 4 years. Because most of us don't know that we're abused because we're so caught in the illusion of love. We aren't too sure what abuse is and what making love is. So only when you reach a point where you can look back and put the dots together like Steve Jobs says, you are able to understand, no, that was not making love, I was probably raped. I was probably abused. It wasn't what it was because I was manipulated emotionally, mentally to think it was love, but it wasn't. And that period went on for 6 years, and so I was in probably my mid-20s, probably 26, when I had to get married, like every other woman had to be, because it was a mandatory thing that came along when you're born. And so my parents started looking, and I had to get out of this abuse somehow, and I thought, okay, you know, what's more stupid than getting out of it than getting into an arranged marriage? So I thought that was an escape system to get rid of something that was already blocking my mind for a long time. So I had an arranged marriage, and I moved cities. I moved to another city and I lived there. And to only find out marriage was falling because I hadn't met the man I was married to before marriage, except the time I was engaged. And when already there was something that was falling into pieces, I had this person who abused me come to another city and stalk me and blackmail me. Through various means of us having been together before. And it came to a point where none of it made sense. Life itself didn't make sense. And so we're all pushed to one particular space at some point of time in life when we aren't too sure whether there's a step or there is just a cliff and we're going to fall. And I was ready to fall because I couldn't take it anymore. I couldn't walk because physically I couldn't walk for 6 years because of the abuse. Now mentally I couldn't walk because I had given up on life itself. And so which is when I thought, okay, you know what, what's easier than life than attempting suicide? So which is what I decided. And suicide failed me too. So I wasn't sure what I was good at, life or death. And I decided I wasn't good at both. So what do I do? And it came a point in time where, I don't know, I think there is this eureka moment when life throws at you. The moment is always there. You just switch off the light and not see it. So there was, I think it was early 2013 when I was still married in my earlier marriage. When I had told my ex-husband, you know what, this person is coming to this city and stalking and blackmailing me and he's almost threatening to murder me. And he said, it's your life, get it sorted and come back. And so I wasn't too sure what to do there. And then I had to quickly go back, come back to Chennai and legally had to fight a case to make peace with the person who was abusing me. Then went back to Bangalore, which is where the city I was living there, and had to legally end the marriage as well. And all this happened within 48 hours. I was thrown out of the house because apparently they thought I am a black mark to the family that I've been married to. And so I still remember like yesterday, though it was a couple of years ago. And I was thrown out of the house. So my parents came and supported me because I told them I came with my head held high and I will not go holding it now. So I went with my head held high, leaving the house that I came into with my parents' support. And so I lived in a lodge for 29, 30 days because it was a new city. And I still remember it like yesterday. So that night, I looked at the ceiling and all I had was nothing. So 48 hours ago, there was two men who was holding my life. And today, my life was all that I had with me. And there was too much freedom and I didn't know it was suffocating. And I wasn't too sure how to handle freedom because I wasn't given freedom to handle it before. And that is when I tasted freedom and oh boy, it tasted brilliant. So from that day till now, I think I have been free, I have been happy, and I met the love of my life, Vijay, whom I'm married to, and I'm very happily married today. And Vijay and I met through social media, and then I shared my story, and he said, I won't fall in love with you, because your story is so good that you will be better. And so we got married, and here I am sharing more than abuse, it's happiness that's got me here.
I came to Chennai in 2002. Like every other engineer, and I had to start in IT, and I had some success in IT. In very early, you know, experience, and I took role of an architect. I had huge success in a couple of projects, and life was alarmingly successful. There was no failure except work. In life, there is no issues. One fine morning, I just settled down, and then I asked my father to look for a girl, like typical South Indian way. And he did all the background work and then find his family. And like any other traditional marriage in South India, we started with problems. So starting from custom, sari, shirt, color, whatnot, anything to everything, it became an issue in marriage. Even on the day of marriage, I'm still not sure that, you know, I'm going to, I don't know. So that's what it was. And things got settled down, and we thought it, you know, over a period of time we have an answer for everything. So that's what I was hoping for. And I came to Chennai, and then the girl, my wife named Poonma, she's from Chennai. They were in Kenya. So, still things were not sorting out. From there and at my end, after marriage problems were still going on, I still don't know what to do. So having problems in a team is very easy to resolve. And I have done it several times before that. you call for a meeting and then you raise on the agenda, you make them explain why it is an issue, things will go off in a week or so. How do you remove them? That's what I was hoping for. In family, how could I do this? Or how could I make this happen in family? But switching from a professional to a family man and going through this issue, having a problem within the team, was very difficult for me. So I was still deciding to see what options I can consider. Out of nowhere, one fine evening, life hit me. We sort of had an issue. And when I came home, things were all chaotic. So that's when journey started. I was not sure that, something unnaturally personalized wife. Within 7 years of marriage, police does not need a complaint. So the moment I still was not sure what to do. So I went to police and I said, my wife is locked up, she is not opening, I don't know what to do. I don't know what was the status. So, and when we came home and they opened the door, she was already there. So, and they immediately took me to the station and then they said, okay, we'll sort things out, we'll talk tomorrow. And the next day came, we came to know that, there's no need of any complaint, I can be booked immediately. So I was transferred to Pune after 3 days. I spent 6 to 7 weeks prison time. So the actual journey was coming out and seeing the same people with whom I shared my life, be it friends or family, was very difficult. So, over a period of time, I did introspect myself several times. How am I going to do this further? Or should I take the same decision that she took? Or should I stand out and then be normal? So that's what kept me going so far. And then I met every one of the book clubs that we go to. So when he said he has written a book, I said, okay, I'll read it and I'll read it as well. I took it and then certain books I always read without stopping. So I had 6 hours to read of his book and then wrote a page of review. And then next day he called me and then said, we met in one of the coffee shop. And I did not expect Vaani to be present there. It was a little bit of a shock because I was hoping to meet him alone to share my experience. Because I was not uncomfortable earlier. Then when I saw both of them, how they were together, it really changed my perspective. So from then on, he has been a very good friend of mine. So we shared a lot of discussions, conversations in entrepreneurship. But one of the reasons I was able to pull it off is his book. So when I was deciding what to do, his book came as a blessing. Because till that time I was still complaining about why this happened to me. I did nothing wrong. I did pay my due to society. I had done nothing wrong to my relatives. I took care of everyone. And why is this for me? And still I don't have that answer. But after meeting a couple of people like him, I decided not to ask that question. So, life is not fair, but one of my seasoned leaders who always says, life is not meant to be easy. If it is easy, you are not
leading. Thank you. All yours.
Thank you, SG. When I met SG outside, I told him, as Avis Anand said, after I read your story, I feel consoled because my story is nothing compared to yours. Because even when a police stops us and has us at a red signal light, we are not able to take it up. Hats off to you, brother. Now, my story is the cliche, born with a golden spoon. Really, I was born with a golden spoon. I was born in 76. I stay in Chittaranjan Road, Sarapap Road, 2nd Street, just opposite Japanese consulate. Talabidi Muka Stalin has just come there. 5 grounds, bungalow, more than 14, 15 rooms. We have a huge garden in the front and the back. And I studied at Don Bosco in more. My father ran a factory called SAS Engineering in Perugudi, 99 grounds. Ninaikkadai Mudipavan or MGR movie also under my father also was associated as producer. So all this was my identity. Who is Arun? Chittaranjan Road, Perugudi, 99 ground, Ninaikkadai Mudipavan, MGR. My father has, that was my identity. My call to action, you know, Joseph Campbell says, a search from the cinema, you know, the act is basically when you are called to action, unwanted call to action, life becomes unfair. It's when my father had to sell my factory. See, basically when I heard Avis's story, it was mainly about how did Avis's children take this up? Because that is what my story is. How me and my sister were not able to take up when we hear that the 99 grounds in Perugudi is going to be sold to Apollo Hospital, now present Apollo Hospital and the Cognizant Center. It was our property. And when we hear later that the Chittaranjan Road property is going to be auctioned by HDFC Bank because my father pledged it for a mere 75 lakhs, it shook me. So that is my story, and at the heart of the story is after I got married, I was full of jealousy when I see anybody rich, you know. When I see anybody rich, jealous. Because I was very rich, my father. When I saw my Akhila was the first wedding in the family. I think very open to you. When I saw the second wedding in her family, that is my brother-in-law. Akhila is my wife. When I saw my brother-in-law getting married, I saw the amount of dowry he collected, the amount of wealth he got, and I couldn't digest it. And in the depression of the thought itself, that my brother-in-law has become so rich and my father-in-law didn't do anything to me, I became an alcoholic, to be very open with you. So that's my story about what happened after that. Thank you.
Thank you. He's sober now, as in not just now, but he's off alcohol. He went to a rehab camp and he's out of it.
Excuse me.
But he's going to, he's still searching for himself. And that's the journey that we're going to cover in the conversation. I'd like to start with Shaka. Why does it take, when we're in the throes of a problem, and this happened to me also, so it's more to share notes. Why does it take us so long, or at least did you reflect on it, why does it take so long to realize that we are in a mess and we can take cognitive action to resolve that mess? Why does it take so long?
Why does it take so long? So when I was 18 or 19 is when I met this man, and the abuse went on until I was 25, 26. It was not just hitting on the face abuse, it was being tied naked in bed, kind of an abuse. It was, yeah, now it's okay? Okay. So as much as poetically it might sound, it was not just my dress that was black and blue, it was my skin too. That is the kind of abuse that I went through. And for a long time, I thought the abuse was out of love. And we're all in the illusion of love, no matter what relationship we are. As big as abuse, as small as calling us names, we just take it with a pinch of love and saying, it's him, it's just her, it's going to be okay, and love is bigger. We don't say, we are bigger. It took me six years to say, I'm bigger than the love that I had for him, because it wasn't love itself. The abuse started when I had to withdraw from the relationship because I saw it had no future and I wanted to withdraw. And which is when I started, not generalizing any gender here, but then each gender comes with a set of ethos. You know, the ego of a man is much higher and larger than a woman. Let's just accept that across the table. How ego is represented in a degree of it varies from man to man. So when a man has said no, not every man takes it in his stride. So there are men who come out and who show the power and say, you know what, how can you say no to me? And so when I started suppressing, and it is when fear succumbs you, nobody including you can help yourself because it becomes so huge, it occupies every space, every thought in your mind, and that's what it happened to me. It's not that I didn't have belief, it's not that I didn't have hope. I still had hope for a better sunrise tomorrow. But then every day sun was rising, but it took 6 years for me to go see the sunrise. And every time I used to get abused, being a single child, I used to come home, there used to be mom and dad, and my pillows were wet every night because I used to get abused on my shoulder, I used to get abused everywhere, it used to hit me every day. I used to come home and because I don't want mom and dad to go through what I was going through, you know. And that's when we make a mistake, thinking, you know what, I don't want Amma to know about this. I don't want mom and dad to go through what I'm going through. The mistake that I did was not sharing what I was going through with parents. Once you start sharing what you're going through with parents, you will see solutions appear magically in front of you. Because you refuse to share because you know something is wrong with you. If you knew everything was right, you wouldn't stop it with you. You would go and tell mom and dad. Like we get a first run, we go tell mom. Like when we do something nice, we go tell parents. So for a long time, I didn't tell them. And it was refusal of accepting the reality. And it took 6 years for me to look at myself and say, hey, you are being abused. Get up and stand for yourself. Because I saw losing me in the entire 6 years. And I'm 34 and I've still lost 8 years of my life. And now I can't go back and live it. But I'm doing things that I think a 21-year-old would do. And that's the only way I'm reliving life. So we all, some people take a week, some people take a year, some people lose a lifetime. But then here I am facing it. And it all requires that moment of faith. It's a huge leap. Faith is huge. It's not as small as you can put it in a box and say, oh, this is what faith is. But faith is huge. And you have to accept faith and belief and truly believe that something's good there out for you. And as cliche as it may sound, today when I look back, I don't feel the pain on the right shoulder. I don't feel the pain on my thigh. But the pain was here for a long time. It's still there. It's still there. So yesterday when I was meeting someone for lunch, she said, are you not done talking about your abuse? I said, I'm never done talking about my abuse. A day when India comes when we have zero abuse, that day I'll be done. Until then, I will never be done. I will keep talking because someone out there is silently going through abuse, either emotionally, physically or mentally. And if we don't speak up for someone, then what humans are we?
You know, Sharada, it's so well said, you know. This whole thing that, you know, the belief that you spoke about, the faith, that things are going to be better one day. You know, I've always believed that there is, you know, when the day breaks, you know, you always hope that today is going to be a better day. And I can so relate to what you're saying, you know, because, you know, I can just see the pain that you've undergone. And, you know, I think all of us undergo pain in some form. And, you know, I think one of the biggest things is the acceptance part of it. The minute you accept that you have a problem, you're closer than ever to a solution. Till that, you keep searching and you're not going to get close to your solution. The minute you accept that you have a problem, then it's easier. Then the faith comes in automatically to believe that there is a solution and you can take it forward from there.
I think most of us think that accepting and acknowledging we are going through a phase is weakness, but it's not. It takes tremendous courage to look at the mirror and say, hey, you know what, you're going through a problem. Face it. Every day we get up and say, it's okay, it's yesterday's thing. No, it's happening today because it's still there. It's still there in your life, small or big. So as you beautifully said, accepting, looking at your problem and saying, you know what, let's solve. You know, let's work together.
Exactly.
You have to work with your problem, not against your problem. Because when you work against your problem, you're working against the solution that the problem is going to give you.
Beautiful.
Well said.
I think just to summarize for the how we can take away, there is a lot of denial that goes on in our heads when we are dealing with situations. There's a lot of denial that goes on. And one form of that denial is that we don't see what is happening. Which is we don't realize something is happening to us. The other form is that we refuse to see what is happening to us. So as long as you are at the denial step, acceptance is very far away. Then comes why me, that question. Then comes anger, because the situation is not getting resolved. Then comes fear, what she talked about. And fear is completely debilitating. And fear and faith can never coexist. If you have faith, you cannot have fear. Fear and faith are you know, mutually exclusive. And faith is not about faith in an external God. Faith is in yourself, that here's a problem. And so she says, you know, what she basically said is, you know, make peace with your problem. Face that reality. So that is the faith, you know, that, hey, this is the problem, and let me face it. Then comes acceptance. So imagine if you're climbing a stairway and there's an elevator taking you up, you'd much rather take the elevator and go straight to acceptance than climb the stairway of denial, why me, anger, fear, grudging, acceptance. You're losing a lot of time. So I've gone through that 6 to 7, 8 year phase of struggling, resisting and all of that. Thank you. I want to go to Arun now and ask Arun, when you say that your father's financial situation made you emotionally very fragile, okay? When you say that you were dealing with emotions like jealousy, which made you ask Akila to ask her dad to support your business, okay? What was troubling you at that time? Was it that your father was going through distress? Or was it that you were being denied comforts? And when you look back now, did you are you able to reason with that time of yours, the way you were at that time? Do you like the person that you were at that time? And how are you dealing with that distress within your head?
See, the greatest humiliation that I have faced is falling at the banker's foot. The HTLC fellows will come with cigarettes and sit on their bike.
Switch on the mic, sir. Switch on the mic.
The mic is on.
Oh, no. Hello. Yes.
No, it is on.
It is on.
We're just getting some feedback.
Yeah. Hmm. Feedback. Yes. As I said, I had to literally fall on a person's foot, which I have never done from birth. As I told you, HTLC fellows will come and sit with cigarettes outside. And they will put the pressure on my father. He will put the pressure on me. And me and my sister will go to my mother and harass her to give her jewels, and we will go pledge and pay the EMI. That kind of trauma I am not used to. Then we will lock ourselves inside the house. And I can hear debtors coming and kicking the gate and saying, you look, your bill is such a big house, he cannot even pay a small amount. So that was very traumatic. And see, basically it was trauma. Appa's debt was handling these debtors, I couldn't handle, sir. I don't know how you are handling. I couldn't.
Arun, I want to say something.
Yes.
Here. I think the pain is about people not believing you, people not trusting what you're saying.
Yes.
And this I often share with people.
Yes.
That especially when it comes to a financial problem, people are not ready to accept. There's a lot of judgment and stigma attached to a financial bankruptcy. If sitting right here was a cancer survivor, he or she would have been celebrated as somebody who has overcome something
And you know, it was a physically debilitating thing is not something that you caused, right? I mean, it's a life situation, it's a God situation. So, you know, people are ready to say, oh, power, you know, he or she could not do anything about it. But when it comes to financial bankruptcy, there's a lot of judgment by people saying, oh, you don't have money, you must be a moron. You know, come on, don't tell me you couldn't do anything to earn some money. You know, I've faced those situations, and you know, I often talk about the three A's that people judge people on. You know, A is attitude. Okay, if you're financially bankrupt, you're not supposed to, you know, be happy, for example. Like, how come you're like this? You owe people money, right? You have no right to smile. You know, your whole life is under a debt. So unless you repay the debt, you have no right to smile. First A. Second A, that is, first one is attitude. Second one is attire. How come you're so well turned out? You know, oh, interesting. Where did you make that up? You know, that's the thing. The third thing is, you know, address. Oh, like he said, Senator Road la veedu irukka. Neenga eppadi indha flat la irukkeenga? How can I believe that you don't have even 500 rupees to pay me? I said, I don't have money to buy provisions, believe me. There have been days when there is no money to buy provisions. One day there was just one onion in my house, and all we did was we made khichdi with basmati rice and moong dal, and onion with the onion that we had. We made a raita and we all had lunch. And you know, when I tell a guy who's on my door, I can feel that pain.
So it was very traumatic for you. You how did that moment of transformation come to you? So you took the alcohol, and you must have, you tried to give up alcohol once and then you couldn't, and then you went back to the habit. But how did it change? What changed in you that got you to deal with your trauma, accept your alcohol problem, and come sober? And it's a big challenge that you overcome. How did that happen?
I mean, just go back to trauma. You know, one of the things I cannot forget is, see, Vaani Akka, she's bold. My mother is not like that. I have seen my mother, she pours herself naked. I have never seen my mother naked. So that is still in my mind. I mean, she lost her mind. She tore herself naked one day and she ran out naked. We had to pull her and like push her on the bed. So these are the traumas I have gone through. And my alcohol addiction is completely not related with Appa's death. It is another story. You want to talk about it now or?
No, talk about how you released yourself from alcohol.
Sir, alcohol, I had to come out, sir, otherwise I would have died. It was, see, to be very frank with you, I am 100 kilos now. I shot up to 130, so I couldn't carry my body. Night I couldn't breathe. It's not a joke. I used to get up at 2 o'clock, shortness of breath. I went to Bombay. I blew all the money in search of rehab. I didn't get any relief at Bombay. I got relief at an ordinary alcohol anonymous center in a corporation school in Tinagar. For which you must clap hands.
So, my question really was, in the padakatha udanongra nambike varanum illaya, it's a padakam, right? Your hand will go back, your car will go back, you will go back to the bar. How did you snap out of it? What internal thought process led you to snap out of it?
I really believe it's a miracle, because it is not out of my willpower. And the operation school at Tinagar, because I have gone to Bombay and spent all my money and I didn't get relief. Something was there at the Kesari High School at Alcohol Anonymous. I saw auto drivers, rickshaw drivers coming and speaking, and something therapeutic happened. I really don't know, but even if you give me 1 crore, 2 crore, I will not touch alcohol again, because you threw me back. I have a lot to talk. We'll talk later. I feel sad for my wife.
I have a question on that, but I'll come to that in a bit. I want to just amplify this beautiful point he said. You know, it is a miracle.
Yeah.
You know, I think if you ask me and Vaani, how are we facing life? If you ask Sharada, how is she facing life? Shankar, how is he facing life? It's a miracle. And it's a miracle is possible if you let go and trust the process of life. So I think whatever it is, it wasn't
ordained to happen in Mumbai for him. It was ordained to happen in a small Tinagar school, in an Alcoholics Anonymous group. And I think we have to acknowledge that life has got a very beautiful method which we can never comprehend. So if it had not been for that, we wouldn't be having Arun here. So thank you, Arun, for sharing that. Shankar, you have a question for
us? No, I was just wanting to say that life's design, life has got a design of its own, and each one of us has got a unique design. You know, I think when either we come in between it, or society comes in between it, you know, these social so-called taboos, you know, Shankar spoke about how the marriage was really not between him and Purnima, but it was more between two families, and you know, unfortunately, you know, the couple had to have, you know, had to go through so much because of the pressures of the social conditioning that they were in, to the extent that, you know, she decided that the easiest way out was to end her life. I mean, how bad must the social pressure have been for her to take that decision? And look at him, he was already under the trauma of having lost her, and on top of that he was put with another trauma of having to spend time in a prison. Now come on, we've come close to that stage when, you know, there were police at the door and we were taking you to the police station. I was standing outside E4 police station, Abhirampuram, at 11:30 one night, and you know, with nobody to call, I didn't know whom to call. You know, I didn't know what to do. So I know how that feels, you know, and maybe you can say something about social judgment.
Yeah, my question was really that.
Yeah.
Redeeming yourself, is it possible at all? Is it worth it to explain to society that na inda tappu pannala idella soonilella maatinte? Is it relevant at all to explain to society, and how are you coping with it now?
Up to certain extent it's yes, because during the process everyone whom you meet, they assume, what did you do, how did it happen, why you could not handle it properly. And it is very easy to ask those questions, because I was in the station for 4 days, and there were several divisions of police department, and everyone had the question from their end. There is vigilance and intelligence bureau. Everyone was inquiring from their end what had happened in the 6 months, and how was the life, and how are the other factors? When it went to an extent that, how was the sex life? I could not, you know, tolerate or even accept that why, you know, all this has to be a question for something that has happened on its own. And how I say that, I am not the sole reason for it, but as part of the structure that we are, I have to face it completely. And there was a small factor that was positive during that time, was she was not pregnant. Otherwise, there has been another section would have added as part of the existing case.
Okay.
So if a girl is committing suicide and she is pregnant at that time, another section would be added to the structure. So out of nowhere, because I never met a wife before my marriage. Now, explaining all this and then how to come out of it, I mean, not from a spiritual point of view, at least law is, you know, I have to come out of this, I do not know what to do. We had one lawyer who was representing for bail or executed 6 times. And I already spent all my savings on marriage. I spent 8 lakhs. And there was no money to even put application for bail. So my mom's jewelry, everything was sold, and then to come out, it was really difficult from a financial point of view and emotional point of view. But one good thing happened was, you know, I was able to meet people who were like me in prison, who are in a much better position in society. So, but at least they had the muscle to move things through. they were out of prison in 2 weeks. So I could not make enough for my family, but nobody didn't want to see me at that time because I would be concerned. And people started questioning me in prison that, do you have anyone outside who is working for you? I said, they will be busy, so why come here unnecessarily? So that is when they also decided that they started judging that I am not a nice guy.
Okay.
Something.
No one is coming to see you.
Yeah, no one is coming to see me. So I have a brother who is fighting hard for this, running from the station to the kind of office and getting approvals in the room. But I said it's okay, I don't mind. Luckily I had a reading books which kept me going there. But coming on, I could not see the same people again. Be it family or friends, I was, I don't know when I was going to come out, and for your information, you will never know. You will be caught on a mic. It is possibly 6 to 7 acres of place. It will be called an announcement that you know your bail is approved, you are free to go.
Well, otherwise you don't know.
Otherwise you will never know. So that's how our system works. So people were waiting for that call, waiting for that announcement. So when I came in, there is no money as usual. So from Pearl to reaching my rental house, I did not know what I'm going to do. So but luckily the system allows convicts to travel free for the first time. So they put a stamp on your hand, if you show that to bus driver, they will allow you for free. So that's how I came to house. And the first few weeks I didn't talk to anyone. And all my friends, my mobile is on the system, so I was still trying to accept the fact that is this really happened. So then I changed profession over a period of time and I took up something that is close to my heart, which is
investment.
Investment. So that kept me going for a long time.
That's a beautiful point he's making. I think in a way, we all look for social approval, and especially in situations like the ones that we are sharing with you, you are not going to get that social approval because society has not been through this. Society likes to work in its own framework, right? So if you are in jail, then you have done something wrong. You know, if you are in debt, you have done something wrong. If you have gone through sex abuse, then something you could have done something wrong, and on top of it, you write a book on erotica. So
being a woman is enough.
Yeah, being a woman is enough. So you have those social frameworks, and they will never match. But I think one of the things I'm able to resonate with you, and with you, you also dived into writing, and you may like to pick it up, Arun. We talked about it the other day over coffee. If you're passionate about something, immerse yourself in it. Shut yourself from all worldviews. Not to go into isolation, not to become a hermit, but to, when you shut yourself, if you look at top players, athletes, they will not read the newspapers, they will not watch television, they will concentrate on their game. And the game of life is a great game to concentrate on. You got to win the war, you got to last, and to last, you cannot be responding to every stimuli. Somebody will call you a name, somebody will pinch you, somebody will write you off. You know, you can't keep responding to every stimuli. So I immerse myself in writing, and that's how the book itself happened. So you immerse yourself in investment business, which is really was an ability to kickstart your career as well as your, it gave you joy. You immerse yourself in writing. So that's something that you may want to take away, Arun. The passion part. What are you deeply passionate about? Find that and go after that. So, do you want to ask a question?
No, I just want to make another point there. I think, rather than looking at what society is pinning on you, they're constantly pinning labels on your head. And AVIS is a very nice metaphor for this. People say, how do you deal with this? They constantly putting metaphors and sticking something on your head. So he's got a metaphor. He says, whatever they put, just imagine it's on a post-it pad. Okay, you have those post-it pads that you can peel off and stick on something. So if somebody's sticking something on you, just peel it off and give it back to them. Okay, so that's the best way to deal with it. That's one of the things I wanted to say. And the other thing I wanted to say is that it's important that you are true to yourself. You know, it doesn't matter what somebody else thinks. You know, if you're able to face yourself in the mirror and you feel you've done the best you could, you've done whatever you could, and you feel you've done whatever the situation needed and given the strength that God has given you, I think just being true to yourself is good enough. There's no need for a social judgment. It's enough if you can evaluate yourself and feel happy that you've done enough.
You don't need a certificate. That's
adding
right.
to the passion that one needs to go through and adding to social judgment, putting both of that into one box. I have a very small point to make was that, so when I was going through the divorce from my first marriage, I lived alone. And until then, I didn't know what passion meant because I wasn't raised to have a passion. I was raised to have a job. And I wasn't too sure whether what existed, whether I was passionate about something at all, if there was something left in me to be passionate about. And I rented an apartment and I lived alone. And I used to sit every night in the balcony because I used to be scared of dark. And being the only child, I was raised to sleep with mom and dad until I got married. And then sleeping alone was huge in a two-bedroom apartment. And I didn't know what to do to while away time. And I just started writing what went through in my life. And I thought that's a beautiful way to channelize pain. Because when you channelize pain into something that doesn't require an external source, that you can channelize yourself with very positively, nothing can, passion can never let you down. I keep telling this million times and I never lose faith in saying it. Passion never lets you down. It's people who let you down. A guitar or a writing or a camera never tells it you saying your acting today sucked. A director could tell you, a co-actor could tell you, another writer could tell you, but your writing will never tell you stop writing today. So be very monogamous with your passion, whatever passion you could have, don't cheat on it. Because I never cheated on it. I kept keeping the passion alive. And in line with social judgment to what Vaani said, I started writing erotica because I was very sensuous by nature in my mind. And erotica came so naturally to me. I was very good at it. So I started writing about it. So the first thing was erotica. Second thing was women writing erotica. I don't know how childbirth happens. Men look up and children come down, I don't know. I'm sure women are a part of childbirth. And we're also a part of how reproduction system happens. So I write the same way in a very poetic way. And the minute I started erotica, my others inbox on the Facebook started filling up and saying, you're writing erotica because you must be interested in sex. You know, so can we meet? I'm sure sex would interest you. And that's a social, I could be writing on murder, I'm not going to go and murder you. You know, so like following something that you like doesn't tantamount to that having to do anything with the society, but it's more to do with what you like. So immediately your passion is, don't let that down because that's what is going to keep you alive in an insane world. So which is something that I really wanted to say.
Beautiful. I think I love that. Be monogamous with your passion. That's a lovely quote. Use it more and more. If it flowed through you now, use it more and more. Plant it. Shankar, I have a question for you. Despite what you've gone through, you seem to be better from the experience and not bitter. Right? How did you let go of the bitterness of what happened, of the police action, social stigma, all of that? What did you employ something? Did you go into some kind of a process to heal yourself? How did you do it?
I have a friend, a couple of friends who are much more mature than me in life. I did talk to them several times when they helped me. Whenever they are able to engage me. And so one thing that I know for sure is it cannot be real. So I have to face this
So how best I can do things that I can, you know, avoid the pain. So pain will always be there, but I have migraine throughout my life. So I did research on it, and then every time I take a painkiller, it gets better. So then I came to know that the painkiller doesn't do anything. It just bypasses the signal that pain passes through the brain. So that's what my patient towards my investment advisory came into picture.
Okay, that was a painkiller.
That was my painkiller. So whenever, wherever, if someone talks about investment or, you know, finance, I don't need it, no problem about that. So that was one thing. And the second point which changed me really was I begin to appreciate the people whom I have in my life right now. Because we don't know what will happen tomorrow, either for me or for them. So it is important for you to appreciate them what they are. So that's what you know, I still liking people than I am.
Beautiful.
So well said.
Very well said, very well said. I think conversations really help. Vaani talked about it, he talked about it. And appreciate the people, you know. I think the people around you, and there will be two kinds of people. One kind will only tell you why you are a problem. And the other kind will tell you why you're not a problem. Right? And they're not lying either. Okay? I always lean in the second category. You know, I'm not looking for fans. But there are some people who genuinely feel for you, and they will back you, and you need that emotional, you know, that emotional space to hang out in, you know, if you know what I mean. So beautiful. Thank you for sharing that. I want to go to Arun, and we'll go to questions in like a few more minutes from the audience. But Arun, you're still coming to terms. See, we're here talking to Sharada. And we're talking to Shankar, and you can see that they're, and Vaani and I, we are like a few steps ahead in the journey. You're still coming to terms with many realities in your life. Have you talked to Akila about your problems? And if not, why are you struggling to talk to her?
Actually, Anand and Akka, when they asked me, are you bringing your wife? I almost fell out of the seat. Basically, it's a shame, you know, because my wife is such a nice person. She knew I was under alcohol, and she had never told me, "Kudichu olri yada, you're drunk and you're blabbering." She had never told me. She's more inclined only BSc. She's MSc, gold medalist. You think she can't sense? We Savera Hotel, true incident. I will take her to the rooftop restaurant and I will tell her, why can't I want to go to the toilet, and I will run down to the bar and I will ask for a 120mm raw shot so that it hits, and I will go to the toilet and put Listerine and gargle and go back after 20 minutes and tell just now my stomach clear. You think she doesn't know? So it's basically, I didn't kill anybody. I was saying, just you can convince your wife, but just a shame, you know. How can I tell her all those years when you struggled, when I harassed you? I harassed her. They might be women activists here, but I harassed my wife. I repent. It's just shame. I harassed her in many ways. I told her to go ask her father capital for my business. Many ways. I'm feeling ashamed, sir. There's a beautiful book that I read, The Shame That Binds You. I still feel ashamed of myself.
I'll come, that's a beautiful point you made. I'll come to the point, but quickly in succession, the question comes to me. So what are you doing about your life? So you have a situation where you your business is closed, and you are out of alcohol abuse now, and you are dealing with your demons. You're asking yourself these important questions. You're making these acknowledging statements. But what are you, is there some direction you feel your life is going in? What are you searching for now in terms of a job or a career or a passion? What are you looking for?
So you must understand the context. I was really bought up with golden spoon, Chitranjan Road. Sir, I went to Akimoto. I met a gentleman in Riskatches, Japanese restaurant owner. I went and worked there as a F&B executive. FMP Institute too is a dignified way of saying I work there as a server. So I applaud myself for that, sir, because I am now willing to do anything to come back. So I am penniless fellow. That's the way my appa was brought me up. I was born after 5 years. They pampered me so much. When my father bought me Gatsby 2000 discotheque membership when I was a youth, my mother used to tell me he has given a weapon in your hands out of his love. So today, in that same auction and hotel, I have gone through the back gate and asked for a job. So I appreciate myself now. I am willing even to become a servant to come back again.
Fantastic. That's a great idea.
Avis, I just have one quick question for all three of them.
Yeah.
Very, very quickly, if you can, Sharada, Shankar and Arun. I always believe that since this is happiness conversation, happiness is an idea and it's, according to me, it's not a destination. It's the journey. It's the journey that we are taking, which makes us go through various things. And so, in these years, has your idea of happiness changed?
Such a complicated question, and you just can't throw the board like that. Idea of happiness changed. Idea of happiness was discovered. Change comes when you discover something. And for me, happiness wasn't discovered for a very long time. So now, there's happiness all over me. I have best friend sitting there who has a party to attend, but she's still sitting there, that's Nandita. I have a husband at home who picked me saying, good luck baby, you're going to be amazing. He's on tour. And I have a mom who says, Roma Soliga, but I'm so proud of you as a doctor. And I have a father who makes filter coffee for me every time I go there and buys for me a similar. I have, what's happiness apart from all this? And nothing else, nothing, not the clothes you wear, not the silk sari that I'm wearing now, not the house that you live in. We all still pay bills, big, small, but we still pay bills. Those are something that we deal at the end of every month. But what gets us through, and one thing that you have to accept is you have to keep yourself happy. Immaterial of how many people are going to give you all this happiness. Immaterial of mom, dad, Nandita and Vijay who's constantly around me. There's Sharada inside me who gets up every morning and says, you know what, you're amazing, Sharada. Be very narcissistic. Be very narcissistic. Tell yourself because you deserve yourself more than anybody else deserving you. We don't give ourselves enough credit in a cruel world today. We keep giving credits to everybody around us. Vaani gives to Avis, Avis gives to Vaani, I give it to everyone. But then you tell yourself, I deserve this life I've gotten to be today. Because unless you are deserving for yourself, you can never be deserving for everyone. So I am discovering happiness and it's getting better by the day, Vaani.
Beautiful. Your idea of happiness.
It's very simple, sir. Don't take up anything.
Just be.
Just be.
That's what I have come to know. Meaning, so at least before marriage, I used to have lots of dreams and ambitions. Like, I had a house and a car. I still have written it down some of my things. I want to have 4 cars for each occasion. But after everything that I have gone through, nothing happens. So now it's take a day at a time and then move on. As long as you are happy for that day, nothing matters.
Beautiful.
So, Arun,
have you thought about happiness?
Anand, we have met many times at Escape Cinema, that area. For me, right now, happiness is watching movie. This movie, Manadam, one movie has come. 3 times I saw it. Watching movie keeps me happy. I go to storytelling, Eric Miller, I get very happy. That is my savings in the bank. But whenever that comes down, I don't get happy. Because I have to do something wrong. So, savings in the bank keeps me happy.
Couple of questions. Just one point. I think the sense of shame that he talks about, Arun, is very real. I think we all make choices. We take actions, and when we reflect on them, we wish we had not done some of those things. So shame is as debilitating a burden as guilt is, as grief is, and you cannot progress on any road carrying a huge burden. And therefore, I don't see any point in carrying shame. I would always say, if you have to make a confession to someone, go break it, make it. Be done with it. So you're clean and you're lighter. Now, how that someone reacts, responds, all that is, you know, subjective. You will feel lighter, and that's the way you can move forward. Okay, this is a suggestion. We'll now go to questions, and you can ask directly questions. We have exactly 15 minutes to close, and I need the last 3 minutes or 4 minutes for myself, so I'll time the questions. Please keep your questions as questions. Do not offer observations. You can do that offline with them and give them a hug as well. Okay. Yes, Ram Kumar, and then I'll come to you, sir.
Okay, this question is to all three of you. See, different, each one of you have different outlook towards how you see the pain. You said pain, you say pain is still there, but you use a painkiller. He said that the pain and shame is still there, so he is trying to deal with it. You also said the pain is still there, and sometimes you even sometimes, I've gone through that experience, that you sometimes even get the joy of staying in that pain. There's a little bit of joy in the pain itself, not letting go of the pain in the first place. So what I really want to understand is that, do you think that this ability to get into happiness and do other things is enough, and this pain will always be there? That is that your outlook, or do you see that in the long run there is a process of completely that memory is being there, but the actual wound being completely healed and the pain being not there at all? Is it really possible at all, having gone through whatever you have gone through? What do you think about it? Or is there a question of letting go of the pain itself, or letting go of forgiving yourself? So these are some of the things I want to.
It's a beautiful question. So a process of the pain, the first part would be identifying that you were in pain. Most of us don't. And we go through pain without knowing it is pain itself. Sometimes it could be love, sometimes it could be in the name of love, in the name of relationship, in the name of a job. So identifying that there is a pain, and to come to terms with it, and finding a solution to the pain is not a part of the pain. Identifying the pain, accepting it, acknowledging it, and saying, you know what, hey, I know you're there, let's work it together. Now if you ask me, is it a part of me, it will always be a part of me. The person who abused me still lives in Chennai. I know where he lives. I'm not going to go there, trash his house, and tell him, hey, you know what, you abused me. No, I've let him go, but I've not let that episode go. That's going to go with me down.
Is a charge still there? See, there is a memory and there is a live charge to the pain, where every time you think about it, you feel dukkha, you feel crying, okay? That is, the memories can still be there, but is the charge still there, or are you really letting go of the pain? See, letting go of the person is different from letting go of your pain.
Ram, I have to interrupt. You can take that conversation offline. Let's move to the next person, because for want of time.
The one thing that you said, you know, going through the pain, you want to be in that situation. Yes, most of the times it is true. Because when you pity yourself, you get to think that, you know, you deserve something better. And in order to do that, you need to have a very good supporting system. People who can help you go through that pain. Otherwise, you need to find a solution, pity yourself, and then on top of it, you still have the courage to overcome it and then move on. So, unless until the support system works for you, that situation is not the right situation to be in.
So you count on the support system. Do you have an answer to that question, or you don't? You pass it? Okay. Fine. I'll do it in the summary. Yes, sir.
This question is to Arun. What happened to your father's business eventually was closed, or what happened when your house in different than closed?
What happened to your father's
business? Papa's not retired. 74. The house in Chittaranjan Road didn't go for auction because my mother's three brothers, my mother's own brothers, Kali Tupi and Kasi Uta, they didn't give it happily, they spat and they gave it because they wanted their akka to at least have a house. So the house is thus. And the document has been. See, actually, my father mortgaged that house without my mother's permission. and blaming him. He didn't even tell her. So now the brothers have got the house back and given the document to my mom, and she has kept it safely in the bank locker. Father is retired now. I am happy he's retired.
Next question, please. Yes, Sundari.
But actually, Arun started. My story is nowhere close to his story. But I think that each story is unique. The challenges, the enormity and intensity of the challenges are known only to us and are lived only by us. And we are not here to judge. And it's more about the decisions that you've taken to shake up the dust and go on. So my question is, you know, happiness is a daily thing. It's not about one day you make a decision to live your life the way you want and the next day you remain the same way. It's not that, right? Every day you have to work at it. And when you decide to work at it and when you work at it diligently, the society, many times it doesn't allow us to, you know, get on with our decisions. A lot of people, many of them from our own relatives and extended families, they are okay with the sympathy thing. You know, they are okay with you or what is it, struggling with a problem, but they are not okay with you when you desire to get up and go on and face the world bravely. So how do you do that? Has there been any instances in your life? Because your life has been before and after. So how has people viewed, how has people's, how has their attitude been to you and how do you react to that? To such negative comments and
I have one thing to say, if I'm permitted. But when you become courageous, when you don't allow the fear to get to you and you become courageous, actually, till you're fearful, people will keep beating you with it. Okay? But the minute you turn courageous, they stay away from you. The world is scared of courageous people. Trust me.
Very simply put, when you're looking for me for the first time in marriage, so you know how relatives are. They're relatively very bad. So the first time they started looking for me for a marriage, they said, you have to get her married. And then I got married, and then when the divorce came, divorce was struggle, especially in the community that I belong to. So my father couldn't tell people that I had gotten divorced. So still people kept there. So when I went to function, they'll be like, how is he? And I'll be like, who is he? And then that phase went for a while. And then I had a second marriage. He said, oh my God, why do you want to have a second marriage? You've not done a money back. So I actually asked him again, the bill cut there, mama, so mobile villa, electricity villa. You don't pay my bills, you're not responsible for whatever I'm going through. Unless you speak up for yourself, they're going to. So the thing was, I was never able to speak up for myself. So today they're scared of me. They don't question me. Because when they question, I have an answer with a question back that I never have an answer for. So unless you speak for yourself and you question the system itself, you will never be able to go ahead. Question the system, because that's what I did.
Sundari, I think you kind of answered your question in the first statement itself. We go through unique experiences and we are living them. Not them, not you, not you. My story, I am living. Your story, you are living. So there cannot be a scope for somebody to, they can offer perspective, but if it's an opinion, if it's worth it, take it. Otherwise, give it back to them.
Yeah, like Vaani said, you know, when we try to tell people that we are in a financial crisis, they expect you to be in rags. You know, they don't, it takes a lot to convince them. This is how I am and I do go through a problem.
Right. Good. One last question. There's just time for one last question. Yes, sir. I'll let you.
You said instead of working against the problem, finding a solution to the problem. Can you elaborate? I didn't get that point. How we work against the problem?
So my point was, do not work against. So if you're going to put your problem as an enemy and say, you know what, you've been bad to me, this abuse has been bad to me, then you're constantly fighting against abuse. And you're looking at it as an external source of something that's killing you internally. You know, when you start embracing abuse,
when I started embracing my process, I actually started looking at my body naked in the mirror. There were no scars. I touched my right shoulder. There was no pain, but the pain was here. My problem was not to put ointment here, it was here. So I had to finger my mind and bring all the sadness and misery out, because it was all there. So unless I work with it, I wouldn't be able to. So I didn't want to look at abuse as a bad thing. It is a bad thing, but it's happened to me. So I couldn't blame. So to say, okay, to sum up the point, I would say that don't blame yourself for what's happened. Because often we start blaming ourselves. When you don't stop blaming yourself, you become your own best friend. And when you become your own best friend, it's easier to embrace whatever you want.
So being focused by negativity yourself, working against the problem.
Yeah, so your problem is not a negativity. Abuse is not negative. It's a part of what's happened in your life. It's a part of your life history. When you treat it as negative, no matter how positive you will be, you will start repelling. So you have to turn it into positive and become, make it a part of who you are. Because you can't go undo an abuse. You can't go undo a bankruptcy. It's already happened. So what do we do about it? So that's how we work a lot with it.
You had a question?
Not a question. Although you said no observation, I just want to pick up what Sharada said. I think it's a very powerful point. We had a session here once where we were talking about angels, angelic healing, things like that. So there was a wonderful statement made about the law of resonance and how when you went through that phase where you thought it was love, you didn't even accept that this was abuse. There was resonance there, some part of you which also played a part.
Absolutely.
But then you got to a stage where there was no resonance. And then you were able to see it for what it was. So all the three stories that came in today, life stories, what Avis and Vaani were sharing of their own stories, that the moment you stop that negative resonance, you are free.
Absolutely.
That particular point, I just wanted to leave it with it because I thought that was so powerful that situations or people can't affect you. It's your response to it.
Absolutely.
If you don't resonate with that, you freed yourself. It takes time. Like I said, it could be a minute, it could be a lifetime.
I think it's a very, very powerful point that situations cannot affect us until we allow them to affect us. So one of the things we all have to understand about life is that life had kuch bhi ho sakta hai. You know, it's life. So anything is possible. You know, if each of these stories is sounding very very traumatic to even hear, and you know, there are many stories sitting out there, and I think anything can happen in life. So, and life happens and keeps on happening. It's just a series of experiences that we go through. We label an experience as good or bad. So, we are causing that judgment first of all. So if you get something fantastic, you know, you walk out from here and somebody from the audience offers Arun Oliver a job, you know, look at him, he's already beaming, right? So, wow, something great happened for me. And if somebody says, Arun, I totally disagree with you for what you said, then it's not what you like to hear, right? So you label that as, no, this is not what I want. So I think we should stop this label. Just experience this adventure called life. It's not a misadventure, please believe me. Each of us sitting here, Sundari, you, me, all of us, are given the quantum of problems or challenges that we are capable of handling. Namak vandirukkira sodana vandu namak evlo thaangukuriya sakthi irukko avloku dhaan varum. So nobody's problem is bigger or smaller. And that is why it's an adventure, because we can sit and play video games and say, I'm going to win this game. We can go to a bungee jump and say, I'm going to dive and experience an adventure. Or you can experience life. And it's so beautiful because if you knew all the answers, then this game would not be exciting at all. So we take it that way. And I think hearing all these stories and keeping up my tradition of always closing with a Rumi quote. Okay, I'm reminded of Jalaluddin Rumi, my favorite poet. And he said, and if you quote all these stories, and if you're going through a situation also, this applies to you. The wound is where the light enters. If we have all understood what life is, if we have all understood what happiness is, it's because of the wound. And so I will always say, I'm extremely grateful to you, life, for putting us in this situation, Because without this, I would not have lived from, you know, some years back, the life that I'm living now. So on that note, Arun, Shankar, Sharada, thank you so much. And to all of you in the audience, thank you so much for being passionate and unique. Have a wonderful night and a great weekend.